Good morning, Crossview. We're so glad you're here to join us in worship. Today, we gather as God's chosen people to celebrate our good Father, who patiently waits for hearts to turn towards him. In John 17, verses 22 to 23, Jesus prays for all believers, asking God to help make us one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity, when the world will know that you sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me. So let's stand together and to give honor and praise to our mighty God as a united body of Christ. Verse 17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. Let's continue to worship him who sits on the throne.
Thank you. I'm not afraid to die.
Father, you are a perfect, almighty, sovereign God. You are worthy of our praise and obedience. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. You have placed us together so your work may be accomplished. You have granted gifts so we might serve you and the gospel in many unique ways. Allow us the strength and courage to listen, obey, and to be your messengers in the world. We love you, Lord, and in your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Crossview. Thanks for gathering with us this morning. My name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors on staff here at Crossview, and I'm glad that you are here with us. Special welcome to those tuning in from Wood County Jail this morning. We're glad that you're following along with our service as well. If you're a guest with us, we have a gift for you at the Welcome Center. You can grab that on your way out, along with some information about who we are. If you consider Crossview Church your church home, your church family, or you're a member here, and you'd like to give as an act of worship, you can do that in any of the usual online ways or at any of the black boxes throughout the building. Kids, you can head on out to Sunday school right now. Parents, if it's helpful for you to escort them to their classrooms, you are free to do so. Otherwise, I have just three announcements for us this morning. So first, right after this service, so at about 11:45 in the community room, that's the one right there, we have Connect with Crossview. So if you are newer around here, you've been attending for, I don't know, less than 6 or 8 months, something like that, and you want to hear more about who we are, meet our staff, hear some of our beliefs and our history, you can come to that meeting right after this service today in the community room. Crossview 101 is also coming. So if you're interested in membership here, or you want to take a little deeper dive into who we are and what we believe and all those sorts of things, that's going to be a three-part class that meets on Tuesday evenings starting on the 23rd. It'll run 6:30 to 7:45, and you can register for that one online or in the app, or just contact Tina in the office and she can get you all signed up. Welcome to Crossview today. You didn't need to register for. So if you're thinking about coming, just show up after second service today. Finally, Senior Fellowship is this coming Thursday, the 18th, from 9 to 10 a.m. That's also in the community room. So older adults of Crossview, you can come on out if you're looking for something to do Thursday morning. It's a great time. There are several pastors there. We always have a lot of fun and hear a great teaching along with some great fellowship. So Thursday morning, Senior Fellowship, plan to be here. The Clementis, then, are our missionary of the week. Many of you know them from their time in Wisconsin Rapids. They are serving in Boston, Massachusetts. They're number 14 out on the mission wall, and you can see their prayer requests up there. They're praying for the hearts of unbelievers in Boston. You may know that Boston is a particularly difficult city in the United States to serve in. It's hard to connect with people there, and so praying for the hearts of unbelievers, as well as encouragement for Tony and Stephanie as they continue to follow God's call. With that, would you go to the Lord with me in prayer? God, we pray back the words of Colossians 1 to you. You, Jesus, are the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in you all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through you and for you. You are before all things, and in you all things hold together. And you are the head of the body, the church. You are the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything you might have supremacy. Jesus, we worship you this morning. We humbly come before you, confessing that our view of you is too small, that we turn inward and into worldly things for salvation. Lord, when this text reminds us that it's only because you first raised from the dead that we are able to have new life. And so we praise you for your love for us in your shed blood. God, we pray for Tony and Stephanie as they seek to take that message to Boston. We ask that you would soften the hearts of the people that they're ministering to. We ask that you would encourage them in your call. Lord, that you would let them feel your presence, especially even this morning. Lord, we lift up to you the situation in Israel and all the terrible things that are going on in the Middle East. Lord, we recognize that you are sovereign over it all, even when we can't understand how, when we can't wrestle or understand what's going on or see how things like this can happen. God, we know that you are sovereign, that you are in control, and so we ask that you would work in big ways in the Middle East to bring peace, to protect innocent lives, and ultimately to point people to a saving relationship with Jesus. We know that transformation in individuals and in nations and in the world only comes from the power of the gospel, Lord, and so we ask that you would move mightily in the world today. Lord, now as we seek to honor you with the rest of this service, would you receive these songs as the worship that you're due? Lord, would you let your preached word fall on soft hearts and open minds, Lord, so that we might be transformed by it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand.
Yes. is our God.
Please stay standing for the reading of God's Word.
Today's scripture reading will be from Ephesians 2, 14 through 20 from the New International Version. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who are far away and peace to those who are near. For through him we have both access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. You may be seated.
Good morning, Crossview Church. Thank you, Curtis and worship team. Welcome not only to Crossview, but the Bible tells us that when two or more are gathered in his name, God is among us. And so welcome as well to the presence of God in our midst. And what I love about that is we can be enfolded in his presence and know that no matter what is happening in our world, God is in control. He is sovereign and he rules over all things. Next week, we're going to start a series I've been looking forward to for a while in the book of Job. We're going to go through the book of Job beginning next week. But this week, there's a message that I really want us as a body of Christ at Crossview to embrace. It has to do with unity. And one of the major things that we invite you to do, as our leadership team is doing, is to be praying for the unity of Crossview Church in 2024. There's a lot that's going to be happening, as I'm going to get into in the message, that's going to seek to tear us apart, and we want to be unified, because that's God's desire. So with that, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Jesus, when you were finishing your final days on earth before the crucifixion, one of the top things you prayed for is that your church would be united. And Lord, we know that we can't do that in our own strength, so we ask for your help. We thank you that your presence is here among us. I pray, I don't know where each of us come to this point in our lives right now, but you do. So I pray that you would minister to us all by the power of your word and by the power of your spirit. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. In Northern Ireland, there's a city that is so divided that it has two names. Some people refer to it as Londonderry, and some people refer to it simply as just Derry. The Protestants live on one side of the city banks, on the east bank of the river, and Catholics live on the west bank. And they don't like to mix. They function as two separate societies in many ways. So one person had a solution to try to build a bridge and to extend a hand of unity to bring peace. And so they built this 900-foot bridge that kind of snakes across the river and curves, and it was built for walkers and joggers and cyclists, and they named it the Peace Bridge. That's what they were trying to do. They're trying to build peace. I think the church in the United States of America, and perhaps even other places in the world, is at a place where we need to build some peace bridges. And of course, we may think we build bridges with the world. That's something that the Bible's clear that we do, and we look at that. But I think we need to build some bridges closer to home. I think we need to build bridges within the church itself. Because over the past 5 years, all of us could say we've seen some bridges blow up. And one of the things that leads to bridges blowing up is a misunderstanding of the purpose of church. Sometimes people leave the church for wrong reasons because they don't understand what the church is really about. In fact, every single one of us can be prone and tempted to lose our sight and our focus about what church really is all about. After all, we think church should be the place where everyone is nice, and I always get this warm, fuzzy feeling, and there's no conflict because you're all supposed to be like Jesus, and it's supposed to be heaven on earth, right? We may not, when we say that, we hear the craziness of that statement, but in our hearts, we believe sometimes that that's the case. There's not supposed to be conflict. There's not supposed to be difficulty. It's supposed to be like heaven. Yet, that's not the case. There are many, many opportunities for disagreement in the church. There's differences of opinion, perhaps on budget items, of how much money gets placed and where. There's differences of conviction, perhaps on a certain member's social media page, which some might find morally troubling, let alone there's differences of culture and differences of family and how we do different things. Or sometimes there's just that person that rubs you the wrong way. All of these disagreements and differences at church can drive us crazy. And some of the results of that are sin and things that need to be owned and repented of. And there could be a time when a church is so unhealthy that it is a good thing to leave. I'm not saying that should never happen. But very often, more often than we think, we give up on church way too easily. Jamie Dunlap says this: the differences and disagreements in a church are not always a sign that things have gone tragically wrong, but instead they've gone gloriously right. What if it's God's will that people rub us the wrong way in church? Because it highlights to us how much we still have yet to go to become more Christ-like. And it brings us to that place where we have to give our heart to God and say, God, I'm not following you fully because this person drives me crazy and I want to avoid them. Will you help me be more like you? Maybe God has set up the church so that the things that actually drive us crazy are for our spiritual good. Maybe God set up the church that the things that, dare I say, hurt us in church, I'm not talking about severely, but the little disagreements, the little digs, the things that can be painful on a small, minimal level, maybe they're there for a reason. Maybe the people that drive us the most crazy are put in our lives sovereignly by God, and our response should not necessarily be to wall them off and get away, but rather our response should be to go before God, realize he's doing something in our life, and perhaps even rebuild the bridge. Maybe we're not supposed to be so discomfort adverse, but maybe we're supposed to live in a little discomfort from time to time and ask God and trust him to do something bigger than we can think or imagine. Maybe in that process, God wants us to become a little bit more like Jesus. There's a book that we have available today called Love the Ones Who Drive You Crazy by Jamie Dunlap. And if you get this book, we have it on sale at a huge discount today for $10. We're not making any money on this. We just want to get this in your hands. And if you read this book and you look at this book, you will love this book and you will hate this book. Because it's one of those books. And it's one thing for us to say we want Crossview Church to be unified and have unity, and it's another thing to get to the nitty-gritty of why that doesn't happen. And so I encourage you all to pick up a copy of this. And one of the favorite things I love about this book, at the end of each chapter, there are four bullet points that he calls prayer points. And if every one of us just took this book and went through a chapter and didn't even read it, but prayed those prayer points, it would be transformational in 2024. So I highly encourage you to pick this up. And if we listen to God's word, if we pray these things for unity, if we pray the prayer points in that book, we will make an eternal investment that will do at least two things in our life. First of all, it will make us more like Jesus. Sometimes we become like Jesus only through hard and difficult times. And when that happens, we have an option. We can lean into that, trusting God and allowing God to take us to deeper levels of intimacy with Him in the midst of a difficult time, or we can adjust our lives and avoid hard things. We can avoid the things that make us uncomfortable and somehow create this little utopia of comfort in our life where we get to decide what we enter and what we don't. But if you really want to be more like Jesus, if you really want the hand of God by the power of His Spirit to shape your life and transform you to become more like Jesus, you're going to have to experience some difficult things. It just is how it works. As I get into this message, I want to clarify something. There's a thing that I call a doable hard and a destructive hard in life. Things come into our lives and they're doable hard. We can do them and get through them. There's things that come into our lives that are destructive hard. We should be careful and avoid those things and put boundaries against those things. When I talk about hard things, I'm not talking about launching yourself into places where you've been abused or hurt in the destructive hard. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the doable hard. Because if we're really honest, I think, especially in our culture, we avoid a lot of doable hard. We pull away from it. We like to be comfortable. We even set up systems to make sure we avoid doable hard. But doable hard is ordained at times by God to shape us into the image of His Son. And the Holy Spirit's a gentleman. And if we resist and isolate and stay away from that, we can do that. But if we lean into the doable hard, trusting God, we will experience God in a way we didn't before, and we'll be transformed by His hand, and He will get the glory for doing that. He's glorified by doing that. The second thing that can, reading God's word that we're going to look at today and the praying the points of this book can do for us is it can keep the unity of our church in 2024. During this election season, the enemy of our souls, Satan himself, is going to do all he can to destroy unity in churches. The election is a prime tool for him to use to do that. And we have to be wise. We have to say that we value the relationship and we value and look at the church the way Jesus does so much higher than any other distracting voice we may have to try to pull that apart. We have to be wise. Do we realize what a treasure this is? To journey through life with a spiritual family that has been ordained and put into place by Jesus Christ Himself as our head, to come together and share the heart of life, the tears of life, the joys of life, the laugh of life, and the ordinary of life with one another. We can so easily take that for granted. And it's a gift from God while we wait for Him. Historically, at Crossview Church, we've been a place where you can come, and it doesn't matter your political persuasion. You could be a Democrat, an independent, a Republican, anywhere on the spectrum, and you can come here and worship Christ together and love one another. You can worship God and love those who are different than you. But there's this lie that's been sown since 2020 that says, if I enter a church and someone disagrees with my point of view in certain things, then they are now my enemy, and I have to withdraw and isolate from them. And it's a lie from the pit of hell. Where else in the world can people of different political persuasions, people of different ages, people of different generations, people of different races, people of different experiences can come together in love and worship God together and be transformed by Him than church? Could you imagine what would happen if we lean into that fully and even learn how to deal with our differences in a loving, kind way? Can you imagine what the world would say if they saw that? Because they're dying for it, though they don't even know it. What would happen if they saw a church come together with all of its differences, including political differences, and say, we come together because there's a bigger kingdom. There's a bigger king. And it's not that we pull away and we never engage in our world, but it's that we do so, we engage knowing that we live for a bigger kingdom. And we live for a bigger king. Now, I know some are saying, well, in order to be a true Christian, you have to belong to the same political party as mine. That's where the true Christians resolve. That's where the true Christians live. If you need to be a true Christian, you have to be part of my political party. Here's my question. How about we just leave that one to God? Can we do that? You know, God has a pretty good track record of dealing with the human heart for generations. He knows what He's doing. And there isn't a human heart that God cannot stir, move, change, or transform. So why don't we leave that to Him? And why don't we engage this world in things including politics by realizing that our worldly engagement is second place to Jesus and what He has written and given us in His Word? It's not that we don't do those things, but it's how we do those things. We do those things, we engage the world, and we engage even politics, and we engage the things of our life as being led by the Holy Spirit. Because if you engage things without being led by the Spirit, the only thing you'll lead is a rebellion. A church is focused on Jesus Christ alone. That is the thing that gathers us. That is the qualification that brings us together. That is what makes us the church. Jesus and Jesus alone. Not Jesus Christ in a shared political perspective. Not Jesus Christ in a shared taste in music. Not Jesus Christ in a shared view on how to educate kids. Not Jesus Christ in a shared disdain for someone's social media post. Jesus Christ in Him alone. That is why we are unified. And in the other stuff, we trust God to give us wisdom and grace in how to handle it case by case by case. But we unite around Christ and what He's done for us. And that is so strong. It's stronger. That work is stronger than any earthly work that can happen. So if you have a Bible, open to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians is towards the back of the Bible. Go past Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. You get to Ephesians. If you hit Colossians or 2 Thessalonians, you went too far. In this text, we're going to see three actions Jesus does for our good. But before we get into those three actions, I want to show you something. I want to give you context for this because we have to remember that the Bible was not written to us. The Bible was written, oh, you made my day again. The Bible's not written to us, the Bible's written for us. So we have to look at who the Bible was written to, find out what was going on there, and then from that point, we determine how to apply it to our life. Here's what was happening. At this point in the church, when Ephesians was written, there were basically two groups of people in church. One was what we'll call the Jewish Christians. The Jewish Christians were raised Jewish, like the disciples of Jesus, and then Jesus Christ comes on the scene. He radically changes their life. They give their lives to Christ, and now they're in this really messy spot of how much do we relate to God based off the Jewishness that we had grown up with, and how much do we follow this Jesus into a new covenant? How much do we, what do we do? And they're confused, and it's really, really messy. As you can imagine. It used to be you followed God by the law and the Jewish custom. Now you follow God by following Jesus. And so what do we do with some of that stuff? And it's a real mess. The other group of people that are in the church are called Gentile Christians. They didn't grow up in the Jewish way of life. In fact, they grew up in probably a pagan view of life. They probably worshiped all sorts of things. It was a crazy moment. And then Jesus comes on the scene and they give Jesus their life. And now they're trying to figure out, how do I live the way Jesus wants me to live when everything in my world is opposite that? We've experienced that, right? So they're experiencing that over here. Now, if it was up to me and up to many authors, including Jamie Dunlap, who wrote this book, if I was setting up the church then, here's what I would do. I would say, we're going to set up a Jewish Christian church. And that way they can figure that all out together. They're all in the same boat in terms of their background. They're all wrestling with the same stuff. Perfect. We'll put a, make them the Jewish Christian church. They'll figure all that out and they'll work out what they need to do to follow Jesus. Then I would create the Gentile Christian church. Because it's a different ball game. They're dealing, it's crazy enough, right? So let's just eliminate that one and let it be what it has to be, and they'll grow and learn to Christ. Then after time goes by, see the human reasoning, which is so wise, after time goes by, we'll let these two groups come together as they mature, then we'll have one big church together. God said, no, I'm not doing it that way. God said, I'm going to take all the messiness of this and all the messiness of this, and I'm going to put it together in one church to reflect me, and it's going to be really, really, really messy. And it's going to hurt. And it's going to be painful. And it's going to be ugly. And it's going to be misunderstanding. And people are going to say things about the church that aren't true, and there's going to be things happening in the church that are bad, but I'm going to put it all together. Because in the differences, in the pain, and in the hurt, it's like God's hammer of the Holy Spirit shaping us into the people he wants us to be. And he uses the differences in the church to do that. If we're humble enough to receive that, and if we're gracious enough to understand it. God chose to start the church different than how we did from the initial moment. He wanted to put people with lots of different opinions, lots of different backgrounds, lots of different races together so that those differences would mold and shape them into Jesus. That was his get-go from the beginning. That was his plan. And when that happens, God gets the ultimate glory. We don't. Sometimes we come into a church and we get hurt. Sometimes we come into a church and someone rubs us the wrong way. And I believe because of our culture and our comfort addictions, we immediately look for an out. Or we immediately judge the church. People have come up to me and said, you know, I came to something at Crossview Church and I got hurt because of this, this, this. You know what my answer is? Yes, because we're a bunch of imperfect people. And if you want to join us, that'd be great. But I cannot guarantee you, you're going to come to Crossview Church and never, ever get hurt. Because I don't think that's God's plan. I think he uses everything in our lives to shape us and mold us. And when we're hurt, we go before him and say, God, will you heal me? God, we pour out our heart to him. And then we let him, allow him to move in our life and steer us to a place where we carry out the relationship like Christ would want. Sometimes we give up way too quickly and we miss out on something amazing. We miss out on reconciliation. We miss out on the power of forgiveness. We miss out on humility coming before the hurt situation and say, I was wrong and I wish I could do that better. And someone says, me too, I wish I could do that better. Could we move forward? And God gets the glory. And we are changed. So why not protect that? Unity in a church is not easy. Church is imperfect. But here's the thing. The differences that threaten to tear us apart, The differences that are there to cause us to throw rocks and point at each other, those differences are opportunities to demonstrate the love and grace of Jesus Christ. Those things that we avoid are the actual opportunities to give glory to God and change our hearts forever. When we give our lives to Jesus, we actually surrender our wills to Him. It's a hard concept for us to get, but it's true. When you give your life to Jesus, you are surrendering your will to Him. You are stepping off of the throne of your heart. He is on the throne of your heart, and all of your life experience you bring before Him. God wants to do things in our hearts with people who drive us crazy. Namely, creating us an ability to love. Yesterday, I was at men's breakfast here at Crossview, and I took a moment and I kind of was looking at the room and looking at all the guys there, and I realized I've been coming to men's breakfasts in this place for 14 years. And I started thinking about the people who were in that room yesterday that were there 14 years ago. I began to think about the people who've joined us along the way. I began to think about the guys who are no longer on this earth but are worshiping Jesus in heaven right now, who were once at that Ben's breakfast. And I thought, what a privilege. What a gift. And that's a microcosm of what we experience every Sunday when we come in here. We walk through the hard with each other. We walk through the tears with each other. We walk through the joys with each other. We walk through the highs with each other. And we walk through the ordinary life with each other. And sometimes we take it so easily for granted, the gift that God gave us in one another. We have to protect that. The enemy wants to destroy that. We have to be wise. We can't sacrifice that for a temporary political kingdom in a country that's going to not always be what it is now. We have to be careful. So let's look at three things Jesus does in this passage. First, number one, Jesus unites what the world cannot bring together. He unites what the world cannot bring together. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, starting at verse 11. Therefore, remember that you formerly were called Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, the Jewish people, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at the time you were separated, he's talking to the Gentiles, separated from Christ, excluded from the citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. He's saying, Gentiles, because you didn't have that background, you didn't know God at all. You were separated. But now, verse 13, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what God does. He takes things that are far away and he brings them near. This was a culture where citizenship literally meant your life. You had to belong to something to sustain. Basic human existence depended on it. And Paul's giving a picture here that the Gentile people were completely cut off from the provisions of God, excluded, separated from his promises. And when you're separated from God's promises, in the Jewish culture, you're separated from life. And then comes verse 13. But now in Christ, you who were once far away have been brought near. That's the gospel. That's the good news. We who were far from God because our sins separate us from Him, because of Jesus and what He did on the cross, are now brought near to God. And then when God brings us near to Him, He places us in the midst of an amazing family called the church. And it doesn't happen when you come and go to a visitor's meeting like we're having at the end of the service, though there's nothing wrong with that. When you give your life to Christ, the Holy Spirit is placed in you, and you are a member of the body of Christ. You are in the church. And in that church, He uses everything the teachings, the relationships, all the events, the things that happen to transform us into his image. And we become the people who are transformed by Jesus in the family of God. See, some people say, well, I love Jesus. I'll take Jesus, but I'm not going to take the church. I love Jesus, but I'm not going to go to church. Or people will say to me, you know, you can be a Christian and not go to church. The Bible knows of no such people. Jesus would have a really hard time with that. Because Jesus Christ is the head of his church. That's what he calls himself. He uses so many different illustrations about what the church is. Jesus died for the church. He gave his life for the church. He loves the church. To be in Christ is to be in his family. He is the head of the church. So the church is to be valued and protected. Here's a little Greek mythology lesson. Zeus was a Greek god in Greek mythology. He had a son named Perseus. And the arch enemy was Medusa. Any of you follow Greek mythology with me at all? Medusa had snakes in her hair. And if you looked at Medusa's eyes, you were turned to stone. It was a defense. And Perseus, Zeus's son, came up with a plan to get rid of Medusa. He couldn't look her in the eyes because he would turn to stone, so he used his shield to find out where she was, to get a reflection, to get close, and then he decapitated her. And then he found out that her head still worked, even though it was severed from the body. If he held up her head at different people, they'd still turn to stone. Christian life doesn't work like that. When you're separated from the body, you cease to give the life that Christ has. You're saying, why in the world are you talking about severed heads? This is gross and weird. There's literally thousands of sculptures of this all over the world. Do you know that? I got a picture of one right here. You'll see this all over. This is a story it reflects. That's gross. We don't like that. Well, you know what? The church seems to like that when it comes to spiritual life. They like to live decapitated. I have Jesus. I don't need the church. Nothing could be further from the truth. What else does Jesus do? Number two, he tears down walls. Look at verse 14. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace. And in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, Gentiles, and peace to those who were near, Jewish people. For through him both have access to the Father now, by one Spirit. What an amazing promise Jesus gives us. God is glorified when two groups of people who are different are brought together in Christ, even when it's hard, even when it hurts, even when it's a mess. And God allows differences and disagreements to happen to shape us and mold us into the image of Christ. Why didn't God just direct his apostles to create two different types of churches? Because of verse 15. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, making peace. Why? Because then he gets glorified. He does what broken human beings can't do. He does what is foreign to this world. Gentiles no longer have to feel like outsiders, and they should not look down on the Jewish people. Jewish people who had no theological ground to reject Gentiles now can only view them as brothers and sisters. Their cultural tensions and differences ran counter to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Jesus came, and by his Spirit, he worked that out. Was it perfect? No, it won't be perfect till he returns. But it's still purposeful. Where there's hurt, where there's pain, where there's strife, God longs for reconciliation. And we, it says in 2 Corinthians, have a ministry of reconciliation. That's what we do as people of God. God longs for his people to be unified. Feed your soul with that kind of message in 2024. For every one look you give to network news, give 10 looks to Christ. Keep that front and center. How can we be unified in the midst of these big differences? Look at verse 18. For through him, God, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. The Holy Spirit resides in us. We go to the Holy Spirit and ask God to help empower us to live in a united way. It breaks the Father's heart when the church divides, especially over temporary earthly issues, because it goes against the very character of God. It goes against his purpose. There's a sin of disunity. Jesus prayed for unity. There's a sin of disunity. And we become comfortable with it. We need to repent of it and seek unity the way Christ wanted. We need to stand together as the people of God in one church. Author and pastor Tim Challey says this, in so many cases, it's not the false doctrine or the false teachers that undermine the church, but a simple failure to love. A simple failure to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. What else, according to this chapter, that Jesus does? Look at verses 19 to 22. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but now, Gentiles, you're fellow citizens with God's people. And also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. Now he gives us a great analogy. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Paul paints this picture of the church as a building. Jesus tore down the dividing walls. He's rebuilding the building, and he's creating a building that celebrates God's presence and his people coming near. When God comes near to us, we at the same time draw closer to one another, who are our brothers and sisters. In this new building that Christ is building called the church, there's no longer isolation and stiff arms. We are now made one. And the oneness is from God, and it's truly amazing. The world longs for a new humanity like this, though they don't know it. This year, guard your hearts. Let's guard our hearts as guard our tongues. Here's a thought. Every single idea that we get in our head does not need to be expressed. Every thought we get in our head does not need to be expressed. Some people say, well, that's not being authentic. No, to express every thought in your head is lunacy. It's chaos. Authenticity is not an on-off switch. So it's on and you're authentic, or it's not and you're not. Authenticity is a dimmer switch. And there's certain people in your life, probably a few, that you peg all the way. And there's a certain people that only get that much. And part of that is because it preserves unity and peace and love. Because no matter where you're at on the dimmer switch, your heart can be full of love for all sorts of people. When someone hurts you, think through it. Is this something I just need to let go and get past? Is this a doable heart? And just pray to God and say, God, will you heal me and help that person? I don't need to make a big deal of this. I'm going to protect the body of Christ. Or if it's a serious hurt and there needs to be reconciliation, then wisely seek that out in a place where two people can be heard and understood, and allow there to be an opportunity where someone can say, you know what, I could totally see why you thought that when I said that. That was wrong. I would think the same thing. I am so sorry. Will you please forgive me? And someone can say, yes, I forgive you. And there can be reconciliation. And you know what else there is in that? Glory to God, because it's him that can make that happen. Where else will that happen on earth than in the church? Protect it. We will disappoint and hurt each other at Crossview Church. I guarantee you that. We are a bunch of imperfect people. And when you come to a Crossview Church event or a group or anything, I can't guarantee you you will never, ever be hurt. But what we do with that hurt in the next step is what matters. And if you're wronged and wounded and offended here, take it before God and figure out what you should do. But whatever you do, don't destroy the unity of the church. I want to close by looking at three quick things we need to remember in 2024. Number one, God is more concerned with us becoming like Jesus than he is our comfort. God is more concerned with us becoming like Jesus than he is our earthly comfort. The primary reason you are at church is not for your comfort and for you to feel good. We often do feel good when we come to church, and that's a great thing, but it's not the primary reason. The primary reason you're at church is to gather and worship and encounter God, and doing so with other people in a corporate setting, and we proclaim together who he is, and the dying world takes notice. Through our actions as well as our words. And dividing over lesser things will destroy that. Number two, God wants us to love and care for one another with his power, not ours. How do we live like this? If we're going to hurt each other from time to time, how do we love? Because it's hard to love when you're hurt. You can't love the way God wants you to love in your own power and strength. You can't. It won't work. The only way is through the power of God. Okay, so how do I get that power? How do I love the way God wants me to love, especially the people who hurt me or drive me crazy? Listen. This is it. This is not the secret, but a secret. You want to live in the power of God and love the way God wants you to do? Here's what you have to do first. Remember the mercies of God towards your life. Remember the mercy of God towards you. Remember how many times God has forgiven you. Remember how God has saved you. Remember how God has said, you can always come to me. When you are at your worst, I am still available to you. You remember that part of God and how his love, his mercy, his affection is poured onto you. And when you remember that, it's easier to love other people who drive you crazy. Because you realize, I drive God crazy sometimes, and he still loves me. He still cares for me. Paul wrote it this way in Romans chapter 12. He said, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy. That's how you're supposed to live. You want to live life to the fullest? Live it in view of God's mercy. In view of God's mercy, I offer my bodies as a living sacrifice. Remember God's mercy towards you. When we think and we remember and reflect on God's mercy, it gives us power to do what we're supposed to do. Number three, God, remember that God intentionally placed us here. You are not here by accident at this church. God has sovereignly, intentionally placed you here. God chose you to put you in a place where people are growing imperfectly together, and sometimes those people will drive you nuts, but he still has placed you here. Jesus unites what the world said has to be divided. And I believe differences and disagreements are evidence that not that something is wrong with the church, but that the church is exactly what it should be. I want to leave you with this thought. Not that long ago, we studied the book of Revelation. And in Revelation chapter 2 and 3, there's a list and letters of all these churches. And they list the good and the bad and the ugly. You saw all the good things in these churches, but then you saw all these problems. You saw all the things that they were doing wrong. And you know what? That's a great picture of a church, because on this side of Jesus coming back, there's no such thing as a church without issues and problems and sin. It won't happen. And so you have these pictures of all these churches in chapters 2 and 3. But then the weird thing is, in Revelation 4 and 5, the next chapters, you know what it was about? Do you remember? It was a big vision of God on his throne and the power and the glory and the majesty of God. Now, why on earth would we talk about the problems in the church and the good, the bad, and the ugly, and then go to the throne room of God and see his glory and his power and his majesty? Why would we do that? Because when we're in the midst of difficult and hard things and hurt and pain in the church, what we need is the glory of God. We need a big vision of who God is. So listen to me on this. Listen. Your political party and your preferred news network will say some good things. They will say some right things, but they will never give you what you need. You need a big vision of God in your life. And they cannot deliver that to you. But that's exactly what you need. And why do I tell you this? Because I care about your souls. One day you will stand before God, and I don't want to see any of you get so dissuaded that you get caught up in a temporary, minor American political system that you lose your soul. It's not worth it. God is in control of all things. You don't have to make it happen. Now, it doesn't mean you never engage, but you engage wisely and not to the level where you sacrifice your very soul for it. We need a big vision of God. That's what irons out everything for us, is God and who he is. So don't forget that in 2024. Don't settle for anything less than God and who he is. I want us to close by looking at this verse, and then I'm going to pray it back to God on our behalf. It's Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2 to 3. It says, "Be completely humble and gentle." This is how we engage our world. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. That means we deal with the crazy and the hurt, the doable hurt at times. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I ask that you'll create within us humble and gentle hearts, hearts that are patient, hearts that can bear with one another in our shortcomings and our failures and our immaturity. God, we thank you that you still love us in our immaturity. You still love us when we're broken and make mistakes, that you are merciful towards us in those things. Let us receive that mercy in such a way that it radically transforms our relationships and our living for you. God, I pray that you would protect us from the enemy's schemes this year and beyond. And until you return, may we at Crossview Church be people who are faithful to you. Not just faithful to you in an individual way, but faithful in how we treat one another as one corporate body that you died for to establish a whole new humanity for your glory. Open our eyes to these things, I ask. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please stand.
There was a moment when the lights went out, when death claimed its victory. The King of Love again gave his life. The darkest day. Oh.
striving for something bigger than ourselves and bigger than the life we know it, and it's Jesus and his kingdom and his rule. Receive this blessing that is saturated with mercy towards you, that empowers us to extend mercy towards others. This benediction comes from Numbers chapter 6. Now may our merciful Lord bless you. May he keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you, and may this merciful God give you his peace. Have a blessed day.